1992, another year of champions for the Mighty Bison. A year of great games and big decisions. The work ethic of the Bison under Rocky Hager would be taken to a new level. After a year's absence as a feared power in Division II, the herd had gathered to mount the charge for another championship. After years of regional competition, the Bison on opening night would usher in new blood from the West Coast Division II fraternity. Cal Poly San Luis Obispo would arrive for a festive and memorable event. The last home opener at Dakota Field. NDSU would begin the process of retiring a football field, a stadium, and a huge piece of Bison football history. 13,200 fans turned out as the herd would score its 29th victory in 32 games in the hallowed walls of Dakota Field. And the defense set the tone early. After a Mustang field goal, the herd's defense, relentless on the attack, saw free safety Chris Strout cause this Cal Poly fumble. Defensive tackle Brian Sweeney was the beneficiary of the herd's hustle and pursuit philosophy and scored NDSU's first touchdown on the season. It was a prelude to the herd's importance on defense in 1992. Nature produced a lightning bolt show that delayed NDSU's march to win number one on the season. Well rested and ready to explode out of the gate, the herd's defense set its sights on the Mustangs' air game and pulled the firing pin. Quarterback David Stainbrook had seen enough. NDSU kicked its offense into high gear with two big plays in the second half. Kyle Carlson took the pitch and rambled through the Mustangs' corral, and the herd never looked back. Martin Beachy filled the air with more than lightning. What struck the Mustangs was a 61-yard touchdown strike to Sean Cahill. Lyle Settensich's visit to Dakota Field was much like the 1990 playoff nightmare. The Bison had just limbered up for conference play, 26-10. Title for the Bison and Rocky Hager started in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. The Bison took the field without Arden Beachy, who was nursing injured ribs. Working against a 40-mile-an-hour wind, freshman quarterback Mike Gidley got his rude introduction into the North Central, and it was up to the Bison defense to guard the fort early. Protecting a short field the first two times in the war, Augustana lit the scoreboard on Heath Rylance's quarterback sneak. The Vikings led 7-0. It was back to the drawing board for the Bison offense. Mike Gidley took to the air. T.R. McDonald hauled in this crucial first down catch. Gidley finally found pay dirt, and the Bison evened the score. NDSU's tradition of trench work started to take effect. Kyle Carlson found the alley and later the end zone as the Bison took control of the Vikings' sinking ship. The defense was quickly making a name for itself. Tim Jacobson turned back the Vikings' highly touted passing game as the herd cruised to the fourth quarter in total control. Augustana's Heath Rylance made things interesting with this toss covering 35 yards to John Legal. Leading 21-17, Rocky Hager threw freshman Mike Gidley back into the heat of the battle and told the Rams to seal the win. An upstart Viking team fell prey to NDSU dominance up front. And Rocky Hager and the Bison left town with conference win number one. It was back home for the Bison in front of 12,700 fans at Dakota Field. Mike Daly and the Jackrabbits would celebrate this former Bison coach's homecoming on NDSU's terms. Senior running back Pete Erickson set the tone for a 449-yard night on offense, going 76 yards on the opening drive. For their 16th straight win over the Jacks. Daly's air game quickly struck back. The Jacks lit the board for 10 unanswered points. But things unraveled fast for the Jackrabbits. A comedy of errors started the avalanche that buried a weaker prey from South Dakota. The Thundering Herd reeled off 27 second quarter points en route to a 34-10 halftime lead. Arden Beachy's 28-yard run capped this 87-yard touchdown drive, and the Bison were in total control. Like sharks in the open sea, the Bison defense smelled the blood of the Jacks. This pick by Chris Strout put the first nail in the coffin for South Dakota State. The Bison played shutout football for three quarters. Mike Daly in the second half could only hope the Herd would show some mercy and remember the good old days. But this young Bison football team had learned only to dominate. Israel Moses, with this pick, gave the Rabbits more of the same in the second half. He had his best performance to date, hitting 8 of 10, including this touchdown pass to Sean Cahill. The Jacks, again, were table scraps to the Bison, 47-10. In Vermilion, South Dakota, the Bison invaded a facility that would someday be theirs. With the Fargo Dome on schedule to house Bison football in 1993, this young Bison team got a taste of success indoors. Arden Beachy went to work on the lame coyote defense. Beachy's option skills helped carve the Yotes for almost 600 yards total offense on the day. With the game less than 2 minutes old, Beachy audible to the side pocket hole and found T.R. McDonald for the game's first score. Beachy later negotiated his way to 29 first downs on the afternoon. Raul Sanchez found the end zone to put the Herd up 13-0. The days of Dave Triplett in the Dome had long passed, and this Coyote team hardly gave the North Central Conference any credibility. Israel Moses stole another coyote pass and turned things back to the herd's offense. Pete Erickson and running back Kyle Carlson turned up the intensity and ripped into the South Dakota secondary for big gains. Off the Coyotes, Rocky Hager turned to the versatile and free-spirited Craig Guerin. The Nebraska Flash dazzled the Yotes for another six. Dennis Crean, in his first year at South Dakota, could only watch helplessly as the Bison scratched South Dakota from the list of contenders, 39-20. At 4-0, the Bison returned home for their festive homecoming show. 13,700 fans expected a usual Bison romp, but saw a nail biter to the finish. The Huskies from St. Cloud were about to strangle the Bison for the second time in 4 years. 800 yards offense on the day would be produced by both teams, and Bison running back Kyle Carlson chipped in the first 69 yards on the day. Carlson's jaunt put the herd up 6-0, and it looked like a day of celebration on the prairie. What followed was a circus event that left the door open for the Huskies. This harmless extra point attempt proved to be disaster by day's end. Arden Beachy, who was leading the North Central Conference in passing efficiency, somehow stumbled into his worst day in 1992. Beachy let the Huskies chew on this meatball, which turned into a feast of St. Cloud points. This Maurer to Gilman connection put the opportune Huskies up 9-6 and begging for more. Less than a minute later, the Mad Dogs bit again. This time it covered 49 yards and accounted for another St. Cloud State touchdown. Arden Beachy bounced back in true Bison form and with precision passing put the Bison on the doorstep. Beachy closed the halftime gap to 16-14. All but eliminated from the postseason equation, the Huskies pulled out all stops and gambled on fourth down. Controlling the football for over 41 minutes, the Huskies, with the counter tray, slipped through the herd's territory for a 23-14 advantage. Beachy took the bull by the horns again. This time, T.R. McDonald proved why he's regarded as one of the best in the country. The Bison were within two and ready to stage the homecoming party. Noel Martin could hardly figure why his team ran out of bounds, allowing crucial seconds to stay on the clock. That's all the charging Bison needed. This scramble to the Husky 5-yard line set the table for the comeback victory. Rocky Hager called on his field goal team to deliver the goods. Football, a game of inches, a game of seconds. This scenario gave jubilation to the Huskies with just inches to spare. For the Bison, it was their calling card to rededicate themselves to a championship season. Through the years of the conference title chase, the Herd's trip to Mankato has always been a red mark on the schedule. Filled with envy, but unable to duplicate the Herd's tradition, the mouthy Mavericks had the home field for week six in the North Central Conference race. Arden Beachy was healthy again and ready to display his talents as the league's most well-rounded performer. Beachy ran deep into Maverick territory, setting up Kyle Carlson's touchdown run as NDSU never looked back. It was a day of interceptions and sacks for the Bison defense. Chris Stroud gave the Herd good field position for Hager's air show. During the week, the blueprints were put together by Dale Hammerschmidt and Chris Simdorn. Executed to perfection by Beachy and the three wide receivers, Craig Guerin hauled in the first of three touchdown passes on the day. The Bison defense put their ears back and zeroed in on a lame Maverick offense. The Mavericks could muster only 220 yards total offense on the day, but got several lessons on how to throw the football. Sean Cahill's two touchdown receptions left the Mavericks tame, but frustrated. While Dan Ruckel took to counseling, the Bison took the win 28-10.
Mankato with a job to do. We came to Mankato to take on a football team that didn't have any respect for us. And by George, I think this afternoon we didn't think necessary to earn their respect. A heck of a job, man, a heck of a job.
As a team to challenge for the national championship, a veteran Northern Colorado team filled with Division I transfers arrived at Dakota Field, posturing the unity that would only be displayed by the Thundering Herd. A team focused on winning their 22nd North Central Conference title in 29 years, the Herd's opening drive was engineered to perfection. The epitome of a team player, running back Mark Hansen, known for his extraordinary ability to block, capped a 92-yard drive with his first touchdown on the season. The Bison defense was setting a relentless pace. The Herd stifled Bears quarterback B.J. Leachman, whose career numbers of 5,000 yards seemed more like a fairy tale. Special teams for the Bison sensed a quivering bear in unfamiliar territory. The stretch drive to the championship was underway. Bruce Yagi recovered this block punt as the Herd trapped the Bears for good. Bonucci was ready to match V.J. Leachman yard for yard and strike for strike. The Beachy to McDonald combination set the teams apart on this day, and the Bears proved to be the pretenders. While Beachy maneuvered the herd to a 35-3 lead, NDSU's defense put the finishing touches on the Bears' postseason hopes. Secondary repeatedly turned back Joe Glenn's aerial design as the clan from Rocky Mountain High found no water able to soothe the wound. On Halloween, the Bison migrated south in mallard weather for their most dominant performance of the year. The program, once directed by the riverboat gambler, had now run aground, and this Maverick dance was a different class. NDSU reeled off 442 yards total offense, and the mistakes on this day were hard to find. With a relentless running game, first it was Kyle Carlson, then Artin Beachy, and Raul Sanchez helped the herd bolt to a 21-3 lead. It was Halloween, but it was also a homecoming for one Bison player to the state of Nebraska who left a big impression in his final show. Craig Guerin traveled 94 yards and separated the Bison from Omaha for good. Guerin put the herd up 28-16 and was ready for any costume party on time. Would not be denied the tricks of road superiority. Gunnar Gossard gave the Bison defense a chance to put six on the board with this block punt. But the talent evaluation held true. The speed and guts go to the defense. The hands go to the offense. Rocky Hager, known for smash mouth philosophy, the tricks came out this day. T.R. McDonald's reverse for the 60-yard touchdown was redefining Hager's rock'em sock'em offense. Sean Stewart and Steve Hansen led the charge up front on defense as Omaha managed only 185 yards total offense. The final trick played by the Nebraska native himself. Guerin's 13-yard scamper left Omaha in the cellar 50-16.
Yourself in a situation where together we can overcome the adversity that arises on each and every game field each and every Saturday. Counting on one another. There's one thing between us and what our dreams are right now. It is time for the Bison to seek and destroy yet another barrier. Choose to make a difference.
In the final regular season home game at Dakota Field, the Bison sat in the driver's seat in the North Central Conference race. The hard-driving Morningside offense, spearheaded by one of the nation's best running backs in Kelly Yancey, would never get out of the pit. The Bison defense on this day came to play and quickly zeroed in on Yancey. The Bison forced four turnovers and allowed just 95 yards total offense on the afternoon. After years of domination at Dakota Field, the Bison defense would leave this facility and its final regular season show with the respect it deserved. Again early in the second half, and NDSU was en route to a 24-7 win. Ranked second in the nation, the Rams up front slugged out 417 yards of total offense. Kyle Carlson's jaunt to the end zone gave the Herd a 16-0 lead, and the talk of Sioux Week had already started. Accounted for 211 yards total offense and muscled his way through the Chiefs defense 26 times. The curtain was closing on Dakota Field. 40 years of football and the tradition of football domination was leaving a legacy unparalleled around the country. NDSU disposed of the Chiefs 24-7. Season. Arch rival UND gathered its fraternity at Memorial Stadium, ready to mount the charge against the Bison. A packed house in front of the highest rated regional telecast in Bison Sioux football history, the Civil War on the Prairie captured all of North Dakota. Roger Thomas and the Sioux held high hopes and aspirations of breaking a decade of losing to North Dakota State. The Bison left the window of opportunity open early with this backfield miscue. The intensity and crowd involvement had never been greater at Memorial Stadium. The Sioux squandered away the opportunity and turned things back to the Bison. Despite having a veteran secondary, UND found out on the ensuing drive what big play football in Fargo, North Dakota was all about. Beachy's connection to Guerin to the Sioux five-yard line put the Bison in business. Beachy followed with the opening score of the game, and the Bison led 7-0. Holding a 10-0 lead, the Sioux offense finally got on track. The Walta-Jelinski connection set the table for UND's first strike. The Bison secondary coverage turned back the Sioux, and UND could manage only 3 points in the first 30 minutes. The stage was set for a fight to the finish. The much anticipated 60 minutes of football left no seconds with less importance. While the Beachy to McDonald connection continued to hurt UND, the Bison became their own worst enemy. UND turned back the Herd inside the 20 twice in the second half. The Sioux struck back with the Thomas Air game. Corey Wall engineered the game to a 10-10 tie. These two playoff-bound teams would account for over 700 yards total offense and would produce the drama a Hollywood scriptwriter would find tough to duplicate. As the thundering Herd turned to the fourth quarter, the dominance up front was apparent. Offensive tackle Scott Fuchs cleared the way for Raul Sanchez to give the Bison a 20-10 lead. While the Bison had done a remarkable job of containing running back Shannon Burnell, Corey Wall again gave UND something to fight for. This connection to Aaron Schramm pulled the Tribe within three. Could this be the year? Did the Sioux have the firepower to end what has become an embarrassing streak in a rivalry that dates all of college football? The screams of Memorial Stadium were heard all over the region. One-point lead, it was up to the Bison defense to place the final grip on the conference championship trophy. For the second straight year, safety Eric Heggerly sealed the win for the Bison, and the Thundering Herd would drive home with the conference hardware. And for the seventh straight year, the Sioux under Roger Thomas fell short in their burning desire and efforts to unseat the Herd as the perennial champs of the North Central Conference. His record, again, still perfect against arch-rival North Dakota.
The second season is upon us. This part of the season is what we bust our ass for in January, February, and March. You exercise the things you need to exercise for us to accomplish the dreams that we have stated on the Pyramid of Success. We're counting on one another. I can tell you right now, man, I wouldn't want to count on a different group of men in the whole world. Thanks for lining up and making it happen this afternoon. Hell of a job.
For the 11th time in 12 years, the Thundering Herd was headed to the postseason, a time of year in which Bison football is elevated to a level known by few programs around the country. And few teams could withstand what the Herd had in store for the first-round opponent from Northeast Missouri State. NDSU unleashed a punishing ground attack that rolled up 493 yards rushing. Three Bison running backs had a field day against the Missouri Pretenders and all rushed for over 100 yards. Pete Erickson cashed in on the Herd's first score, which started a 28-point first-half show. NDSU's defense was surrounding the football and giving new meaning to contact. The Bison converted turnover after turnover into touchdowns. Running back Mark Hansen had a career performance. Hansen ripped through the Missouri defense for 164 yards on 14 carries and dashed the Herd to a quick 14-0 lead. When the Bison defense didn't pick it off the turf, they stole it from the air. Paul Schaffner's interception broke all the confidence of the Missouri Pretenders. This would be the last game at Dakota Field, and this program of pride would not be denied. Bruce Somm's offensive line left gaping holes from one sideline to the next, and the race to the national championship was on. NDSU reeled off 585 yards total offense with a 28-0 lead at intermission. There was little doubt of gridiron superiority. The Bison were now on a course for a showdown with one of the nation's titans in Division II football. Beachy and McDonald continued the onslaught, the Bison defense held the Bulldogs to just 300 yards. As the herd finished the scoring, heading west with Raul Sanchez's 29-yard touchdown run, the next direction was south as the Bison left Northeast Missouri shocked 42-7. Champions, the two most celebrated programs in Division II, had found their collision course at Brandenburg Stadium in Pittsburgh, Kansas. This would glorify college football, and the purpose would transcend the definition of competition. As a player, a coach, or a spectator, few would leave this gridiron struggle, not realizing they had witnessed one of the greatest games of all time. The two most prolific teams with extraordinary resolve had come forth to decide the issue. Two Titans and a battle to the finish.
This is Harrison. Inside the five. Touchdown, Bison. It's fourth and goal. The Gorillas tomorrow with a the gear.
And the Gorillas, it was their finest hour. Respect for the game, respect for one another, and feeling privileged to be a part of it. Both programs in 1992 had reached greatness.
Tied at 31. Moore, touchdown, Pittsburgh State.
The tradition of excellence continues. The 1992 Bison owned and earned their place in Bison football history. They will be remembered as champions for their dedication, their pride, and their resolve to be the best. This program, with its rich tradition, now turns the corner to 1993, and the most celebrated opener in Division II history is set for the Fargo Dome. Thanks to the 1992 Bison, the march to excellence and the tradition continues.